things to do today, and it's a big, OXA is doing a big event downtown, so we want to make sure everyone gets to their destinations after this event.
Good morning, everyone. I'm Pastor Loriana Gardier, and I would like to welcome you to our home. This is Bible Way Christian Center, and we are honored to serve as hosts for such a special event and occasion today, where we recognize what we like to call Black excellence. And our honorees today, we want to just welcome them and thank them for the work that they're doing. And we are really honored to just have everyone in this space today to celebrate these great accomplishments. So one thing that we say at Bible Way Christian Center is that one visit can change your life. And we say that not because of any external thing that we have, you know, our building or anything like that, but we say that because of the spirit of hope, the spirit of God, and the spirit of love that is carried in the hearts of the people here. And so we hope that you felt that when you walked in. And to take us deeper into that space, I'm going to invite you to just join me in a moment of gratitude. So if you would, if you're comfortable, you can close your eyes or just kind of lower your gaze. Put your hand on your heart and just take a breath in. Settle all your thoughts and anxieties and just invite appreciation and thankfulness into your heart right now. For we were all created in the image of God, and we are all loved by God. And at this moment, I would like for us to show gratitude for the boundless strength and wisdom and courage of our ancestors. We are inspired by how far we've come, and we're full of hope and resolve to continue to press toward a future of liberty for all people. Most high, holy, and loving God, our hearts are full of gratitude for your grace and love. We thank you for this valley rich with heritage, beautiful landscape, and a community of diverse individuals. We also thank you for our leaders who value and celebrate the honorable achievements within our community. Today, we reflect on the sacrifice, the triumphs, the setbacks, and the unwavering commitment to excellence that have brought our honorees to this stage. May we not only celebrate their achievements, but also the spirit of resilience, determination, and passion that propels them forward. May this time today be a testament to the power of our people and remind us that with dedication, God, and hope, anything is possible. We pray these things in the name of the one who lives and reigns with the true and living God. In Jesus' name, amen. And now, taking us further into our program today, we are going to invite Sierra Gardier. She is a fourth grade student at Del Roble Elementary, and she is also a student of Destiny Academy, an enrichment program through Bible Way Christian Center. She's going to be leading us in the African American National Anthem. Lift every voice and sing Sierra Gardier. She's also my daughter. Can you reach that? Good. Yeah, right there. Good.
Lift every voice and sing till earth and heaven ring. Ring with the harmonies of liberty. Let our rejoicing rise high as the listening sky. Let it resound loud. Sing a song full of the faith that the dark past has taught us. Sing. march on till victory is won.
Well, good morning, everyone. Thank you again, Sierra, for that, for blessing us with your beautiful voice. Give it one more round of applause to Sierra for the beautiful rendition of the Black National Anthem. Well, good morning, everyone. It's great to be here at Bible Way Christian Center with all of you to celebrate Black History Month. I'm Assemblymember Alex Lee. I have the great honor of representing right here, the 24th Assembly District, which goes all the way from northern San Jose to Milpitas, up to Fremont, Newark, and Sunol. And I have since 2020 now, so 4 years in. And I'm really proud to be recognizing this month and reflecting upon the contributions of so many wonderful folks with you. First, I'd like to thank Pastor Sean and Lorianne Gardier and their staff for partnering with us and allowing us to hold this event at their church, and the culinary staff of Bible Way for providing the food and drinks this morning that everyone enjoyed. Before we get started, I would also like to thank our wonderful co-hosts. First, Milpitas Unified School District Trustee Chris Norwood. Fremont Councilmember Desrie Campbell. Fremont City Councilmember Teresa Cox. And San Jose Evergreen Community College District Board President Tony Alexander, who is also co-host for the event today. Unfortunately, he could not be with us today, though. And quickly, I'm going to recognize all the outstanding allies and elected officials that are joining us today. So if we quickly do this. First is Milpitas Unified Trustee Robert Jung. Alum Rock Union Trustee Min Pham. Where's Min? Oh, there we are. Berryessa Union Superintendent Roxanne Fuentes. Dr. Fuentes, there we are. Berryessa Union Trustee Jariah Haug. Oh, a lot of Berryessa. Berryessa Union Trustee Jai Srivanasan. Mount Pleasant Elementary School District Trustee Derek Gretzky. Where's Derek? Ah, oh, there you are. And of course, New York City Council Member Matthew Jorgens. Where's Matthew? Oh, and we have representative from Supervisor Otto Lee's office, Michelle. Where is Michelle? Right here? Oh, all the way over there. Thank you, Michelle. Thank you for representing my honorary dad. Thank you. Well, thank you so much for everyone being here. You know, today, this is as much extent of my speechifying you're going to hear, because in the tradition of many folks who've co-hosted and partnered these kind of Heritage Month events with me, is that this is an event to recognize the special outstanding contributions of the incredible individuals we're about to recognize. We will be shining a spotlight on 7 awardees, won posthumously, who have made a big impact on people's lives, who inspire generations to come. These are people who have, of course, in the past, made incredible contribution to our community, but inspire us to go forward in the future to do more. In the state legislature, I have the pleasure of serving with 12 members of the California Legislative Black Caucus. We also have 3 Black Americans holding statewide office, the Secretary of State Shirley Weber, State Controller Malia Cohen, and State Superintendent of Public Instruction Tony Thurman. And of course, the daughter of the Bay Area serves in the White House as the Vice President of the United States as well. Additionally, there are numerous Black Americans elected in local government throughout the state here. 3 of them, of course, are our co-hosts for today. 60 years ago, it would have been unheard of, even here, to have so many prominent people of color in government, medicine, academia, business, and high-tech industry. We have seen historic gains over the years, but we still have so much work to be done. And the work of repair, of justice, still remains a top priority of us in the legislature, and there is a long, long way to go. Needless to say, you've probably heard about the reparations task force and the bill package that is coming out, and I plan to work with my colleagues to make sure we have the strongest bill package possible to send to the governor. And as a member of the California State Assembly, I will ensure that we will always be fighting for equality and liberation from all, especially as an ally to the Black community. Now it's time to get on with the presentations and recognize the honorees. So first, I'd like to invite Trustee Chris Norwood to get on the stage with me and start off with helping us honor our honorees.
Well, good morning, everyone. Again, my name is Chris Norwood. I am the current senior board member of the Milpitas Unified School District Board of Trustees. I am also currently the longest elected official in the city of Milpitas. I spent the majority of my life in Milpitas, and I'm super excited to be here today to celebrate one of our educational leaders in the city of Milpitas. One of the things that we have to recognize in public education is that we have so many black educators that don't realize that every day that they're making black history. I'll say that again. Our black educators, every day, they are making black history. So with that said, I'm gonna introduce our honoree, Mr. Sean England. Sean England is currently the assistant principal at Milpitas High School, of which Alex is an alumni. Sean is a UCLA graduate and has been an educator for 27 years. He has a wide range of educational experience, having taught English for 13 years before serving as an administrator for the last 14 years, 3 in East Palo Alto and 11 in the city of Milpitas. During his career, he has created various educational opportunities for students, such as the Pittsburgh High School Bridge to College program that taught students about African American history and provided college tours, including HBCUs, just to name a few learning opportunities. He has also created an introduction to ethnic studies class while serving as the principal of Thomas Russell Middle School in Milpitas. Sean is also a member of the Santa Clara County Alliance of Black Educators and education chair of the 100 Black Men of Silicon Valley, and he is the founding member of the UCLA Black Alumni Association in the Bay Area. Let's just give that a round of applause. And in 2017, he created the 100 Black Men of Silicon Valley's Youth Leadership Academy to educate middle school and high school students on ethnic studies, financial literacy, health, wellness, as well as career opportunities in technology. I met Sean when I first got to the Board of Trustees, and it wasn't at the school district. It was actually out in the community. He was researching technology. He was volunteering a wide number of things, not only in Milpitas, but in the community at large. And I'm proud of the work that Sean has done. I'm proud to have the opportunity to nominate him, and I'm proud to see his family with him as well. So let's give Sean one more big round of applause.
I was remiss in saying that every honoree is given the option of making a speech and staying up here. I know not everyone is a public speaker, so I'm going to give the option for everyone, and I'm going to invite Sean up to the mic in case you want to say some remarks.
Good afternoon, everyone. I think that we all know how important it is for all of our students to be able to see that everyone contributes to making our society the best place it can be. And so one of the things that I've always strived to do is give kids an opportunity to see not just African Americans leading, but also Latinos leading, Asian Americans leading, because they need to see together we can make this society what it is. It's a vital thing. And I'm really happy to know also that right now in the audience is one of the students that goes to my high school. The president of our BSU, in fact, and so Deanna Bigham. So it was just great to see how the synergy works together. I didn't know she was going to be here. She didn't know I was coming, but it all worked. All right. So again, that's it. I really am honored to receive this nomination and thankful that the Bible Way allowed us to be in their presence today. Again, thank you, everyone. response.
Now I'm going to invite our next co-host, Councilmember Campbell, to come up and talk about her awardee. So please give a round of applause and welcome Councilmember Campbell.
Thank you, Assemblymember Lee, and welcome everyone. It is my pleasure. This is my first year as a city council member for Fremont. I serve District 2 for Fremont, and so I'm really delighted that you're here. Thank you, Bible Way, for hosting us. I don't know where to begin to talk about my honoree. How much time do we have? No. He has been a pillar in our community, especially an excellent, excellent spiritual leader. And when I was asked to co-host this event and look at a honoree, I called Pastor Long. I said, Pastor Long, I'm going to ask for permission and not forgiveness. And he said, well, I would have accepted it anyway, any way you gave it, I'm going to nominate you. So Dr. Stanley Long, affectionately known as Stan, is a designated pastor and coach, leadership coach, with a rich history of community and international involvement. In 1985, Stan founded the South Bay Community Church, also known as SBCC, in Fremont, and served as the lead pastor for 25 years. Under his stewardship, the church flourished and became a beacon of hope and spiritual guidance for many in the community. Following his retirement as lead pastor, Stan transitioned to the role of pastor emeritus. Today, he continues to serve the church by providing leadership and mentorship. Before his tenure at South Bay Community Church, Stan served as president of Fellowship Urban Outreach in San Francisco and oversaw the community outreach program that served people in need, as well as the Little Friend Preschool and the Fellowship Academy, an elementary school for over 200 kids. That was a tongue twister, but I'm excited that he's been serving kids because I served on the Fremont Unified School District Board of Education for 10 years before transitioning to a city council. He also serves as the executive director of the Urban Outreach Foundation, an international organization dedicated to equipping pastors, leaders, and churches with essential tools for growth. Stan has served on several boards, including the board of the National Black Evangelical Association, the Fuller Theological Seminary, the Tri-City Homeless Coalition, also currently known as Abode, the Evangelical Covenant Church, the PETNA Foundation, and the Urban Ministries Incorporated. Stan is happily married to his lovely wife, Ruby Pitts. They have raised 3 children. I think all 3 of them are here. And he embraces the joy of being a grandparent of 5 children and the great grandparent of 2. It is my honor and my pleasure to introduce you to my honoree, Pastor Dr. Stanley Long.
Well, first I want to thank Assemblyman Lee and the next mayor of Fremont for allowing me to participate in this event and to receive this acknowledgement. I really wouldn't be a pastor if I didn't say that really I'm not that good. Whatever has been achieved has been God, and he deserves all the glory. But if I could divide this honor up into 3 different components, I would give 1 component to the most incredible wife that a man could have. for over 60 years. She has been, I'm going to cry, the most loyal, faithful, behind-the-scenes supporter that a man could ever want. She gets the first section of that award. The second section goes to my three kids. All of them are devils, I might as well tell you that. They sacrificed so much of their father and never gave us one bit of trouble. And they're all committed to serving people. I'm so proud of them. They get the second half. The third half goes to the members of South Bay Church. Every pastor would give his right toe to have the members that I had. Those people made things happen. And this award, can you get the other third part of that? And proof of their love and loyalty and support is right here. They make up half of this audience. And so thank you. Thank you so much for honoring my folks and honoring them. And God bless you all.
Tremendous, thank you. I'm going to invite Councilmember Teresa Cox to join me for the next honoree. But I would like to thank the South Bay Church for welcoming us last year for our Black History Month event. So I suppose in this continuing event, then now Bible Way will be joining us at our next event, I suppose. So Councilmember Cox, please come up. Please give a warm welcome to Councilmember Teresa Cox.
Sorry, I didn't mean to. I was going to move it. Thank you, I had it adjusted to my height here. Do you know what time it is? It is Black History Celebration time. That's what time it is. I'm Teresa Cox, and I'm proud to be a Fremont City Council member along with Councilmember Campbell. But I also got to give great honor to where it started. Assemblymember Alex Lee, a couple years ago when he ran for office, I promised him and asked him, I said, you got to promise that you're going to celebrate African American History Month because it's an important part of our history. And he said, yes, I promise to do that. And this is happening today together because I became the first African American elected to Fremont City Council in almost 65 years. And I wanted to congratulate Assemblymember Alex Lee, his team, the whole Bible Way, allowing us to be here today. It takes a community effort, and congratulations to all the honorees, because today is a day we're celebrating your accomplishments and the impact you have made to the community. And you know that you are loved by our community, and that's what today is, a special day of celebrating all of you. But also, we know that Black history is a time where all of our people are encouraged to reflect on the past successes and the challenges that are still ahead of us in the Black community. But it takes all of us together to know that we can work together to improve our community, to hold and uplift the ideals of freedom, diversity, equity, inclusion, and justice. So we know that today is a celebration that is a reminder of how we've come and where we need to go. And let's honor our past, celebrate our present, and inspire our future. So God bless to all of you here today. So today it gives me a great honor to be able to celebrate one of our own, Dr. Harry Edwards. He is a renowned sociologist, civil rights activist, who grew up actually in East St. Louis, Illinois. But after graduating from high school, he came out here and moved to California, where he was awarded a scholarship to San Jose State University, where he graduated summa cum laude in 1964. Do we have any Spartans in the house here? Raise your hand. All right, you got even support there locally. And so Dr. Edwards was awarded the Woodrow Wilson Fellowship and the University Fellowship to go to Cornell University, where he completed his Master's of Arts and PhD in Sociology. He also became a visiting professor between 1966 to 1968. And this is what at San Jose State University. And during that time, he wrote the book, The Revolt of the Black Athlete, to document the racism that he experienced as a Black athlete. Didn't that take some strength and bravery to do that? Let's give it up for him. And this meant that you couldn't even be a student, equally treated to live on the campus, have food, be treated to live in the dormitories as other non-Black athletes. And at that same time, he was the organizer and the faculty sponsor of the United Black Students for Action at San Jose State University, where he became a forum for the discussion and debate supporting the Olympic Project for Human Rights Movement. And with this special project that was established by Dr. Harry Edwards, it advocated for the Afro-American students and athletes. It advocated for civil rights and human rights for the Black people in the United States and abroad, such as South Africa, along with protesting racism in sports. And as you know, at the campus of San Jose State University, there's a 20-foot high statue, paused like this, for the Black power of Tommy Smith and John Carlos on the campus to represent and remember the past of what happened when they won the Olympics in track and field. But during the career of Dr. Harry Edwards, he became a leading authority and had the connections to bring together race, sports, and society, where he continues to fight for diversity and equal treatment and opportunities in the sports arena. He has received dozens of awards and honors, including he was honorary doctorate degree, and he was honored by the University of Texas, which has established the Dr. Harry Edwards Lectures, which is a permanent series of the invited lectures on themes relating to sports and society. He went on to write quite a few more books and articles, The Struggle That Must Be, The Sociology of Sports, Black Students, and The Revolt of the Black Athlete. Dr. Edwards is a consultant and advocate for the increasing of Afro-American participation in the management of professional sports to the numerous teams, such as the Major League Baseball, the National Basketball Association, including our Golden State Warriors, and the NFL, which he was right there, who brought the team, the 49ers, to the Super Bowl. you got to thank Dr. Harry Edwards to help them get them ready and the mindset. So give it up for him, because we wouldn't have had a Super Bowl without them being in there. And you see his wife is wearing red, okay? So she's forever a 49ers fan. And we went to honor him actually with Fremont City Council back in December, and he had just had big meetings with the 49ers and said, I'm not sure if I'm gonna get there, Teresa, but I'm gonna make my way, but you know, I got this 49er meeting. So we said, hey, power on, make it happen. We're ready for the Super Bowl. So you gotta give accolades, because it takes a team to get you where you gotta go. And so we're just delighted and honored to have Dr. Harry Edwards as a part of it. Now, just recently in 2023, the Dr. Harry Edwards collection of papers was inaugurated at San Jose State University's Dr. Martin Luther King Library. This was done a few months ago in 2023, but he also received proclamations from the city of Fremont, from the county of Santa Clara, and soon to be the county of Alameda, because you know, Dr. Edwards and his lovely wife live in Fremont, so you know we got to share the love on both counties there. And so it gives me great honor to have Dr. Harry Edwards and his wife Sandra Edwards. They have raised three incredible children that have become doctors, lawyers, going to the top schools in the United States. But they live and have always lived in Fremont now for 55 years, and he is married to Sandra Edwards for 54 years. So it gives me great pleasure and honor to recognize Dr. Harry Edwards. Thank you so much for all of your work you've done in our community. We love you.
Thank you very much, Teresa. I'm not taking a rap for that Super Bowl. we sung a song opening this event, one line of which said, spoke to a song of the dark past and what it is, the faith that it has taught us. There's so much to learn. We commemorate the past not just to honor the achievements and the people who help bring those achievements about, but to learn the lessons of the past. And one of the things that has become very clear to me over my 81 years on this planet is that, one, you can't do it alone. My better two-thirds for the last 54 years has been integral to everything that I have done. And the other thing is that there's a tremendous amount to be learned from even the eras of the past. We have come through as an American society and American people some very dark stages, but we've come out better. 1860 to 1865, we had the assassination of public officials, including the President of the United States, a civil war that killed more Americans than all of the other wars that we fought since then combined, but we came through it, and we came through it better. 1963, through 1968 was another one of those five-year periods, beginning with the assassination of Medgar Evers and the bombing of the 16th Street Baptist Church that killed four little girls who were simply in Sunday school trying to worship, followed by the assassination of another president, John F. Kennedy, on my 21st birthday, November 22, 1963, followed by the assassination of Malcolm X, and three civil rights workers in 1965, and then, of course, Dr. Martin Luther King in 1968 and Bobby Kennedy. But we came through it, but we came through it better. And now we're facing another one of those periods, 2024 through 2029, which promises to be one of the most tumultuous political eras in the history of this country again. But it's a song of faith that brought faith based upon what the dark past has taught us. So we're going to be just fine. And don't be sidetracked by the side issues. Every time I turn on a TV set, somebody's talking about how old the candidates are, that there's an issue of geriatric presidency. They're getting ready to break the records that they themselves set 4 years ago in terms of being, don't be, hey, look, age, they too old, is that a problem that's going to take care of itself or what? You know, so well, I'm not worried about that. As an octogenarian myself, I know where they are. And we don't get caught up in it. Well, where are the new leaders? Where's the Dr. King? Where's the President Kennedy? Where is the Malcolm X? Where's the Fannie Lou Hamer? Where? Hey, you know what? They've always been on their way. That's what history teaches us. That's why we commemorate history, to understand that lesson. Don't worry about where the leaders are coming from. Don't worry about these old folks. Biology gonna take care of that. The history, they are going, that the leaders are on their way. And when she gets here, we'll know it. So thank you very much. I deeply appreciate this. I'm glad that my wife had the opportunity to participate. Like I said, she's not my better half, she's my better two-thirds, because without her, I'd have been on the other side of the cemetery a long time ago. Thank you all very much. Appreciate it.
It gives me great honor to celebrate and bring forth Eta Rho Omega of Alpha Kappa Alpha Sorority, Incorporated. Alpha Kappa Alpha Sorority is the oldest Greek letter organization established by African American college trained women and founded on the campus of Howard University in Washington, D.C. in 1908. So we're 116 years young. The Eta Rho Omega chapter is located in San Jose, but they've been part of the fascinating Far West region, which is comprised of 4,000 graduate and undergraduate members in 9 states, including California. Alpha Kappa Alpha Sorority, Incorporated, has the international theme of soaring to great heights of service and sisterhood. It is the driving force behind improving the lives of those that they serve through the following initiatives: strengthening our sisterhood, empowering our families, build economic wealth, enhance our environment, advocate for social justice, and uplift the local community. Alpha Kappa Alpha Sorority's influence extends beyond our college campus and student interest, and it's basically going on after the college years. Each chapter has a legacy of service supporting the underrepresented members of their communities around the world. Our undergraduate and graduate chapters work diligently in communities outside of the United States. So we're a global organization representing chapters that are in Liberia, the Bahamas, the U.S. Virgin Islands, Germany, South Korea, Bermuda, Japan, Canada, South Africa,
and the United Arab, and also in Nigeria. The Eta Rho Omega chapter actively engages with community partners to sponsor annual projects that include college scholarships and the baccalaureate program. If you haven't been to that, it is something else. It makes you uplift and jump for joy to see young Afro-American men and women being honored for their talents and for their academic excellence and leadership in our community. They do the annual debutante ball, the Pink Goes Red Day for Heart Health Expo, and the DREAM, which stands for Dare to Reach, Expect, and Achieve More. And they also do the House Donation Program. The San Jose chapter also led with Carolyn Dixon. Carol Dixon was the chair of the National Convention here in San Francisco back in 2012, before she became our Far West Regional Director. And if you can remember, San Francisco was covered in pink and green. We had over 10,000 members that flew in from everywhere to come to our conference. And I had the pleasure of working with Carol, and in that role was I was part of the public meeting. And that was to get some of our elected officials there. And if you can imagine, I had to call San Francisco Mayor Ed Lee and say, Ed, AKs are coming here to San Francisco. You gotta be here. He goes, I've got a US conference in Philadelphia for mayors. I said, no, you gotta come, because we're dropping $25 million in a week in the city of San Francisco to help your economy, but you gotta be there. And so he says, well, okay, I'm gonna try to work it out with my schedule. Next thing I know, I get a call. Ed Lee, Mayor Ed Lee will be coming to Moscone Center. Where do we need a report? So we're all in the back waiting for him, because they have a drive-through when you're in that type of status in back of Moscone Center. We're all waiting in the back for him to greet him. And all of a sudden I get a call. Teresa, where are you? This is Ed. I'm looking for you. I said, Ed, where are you? I'm at the front door. We ran with our heels trying to get there to meet him. But I didn't tell you this before. So Willie Brown, he's a member of Alpha Phi Alpha, and of course, we all know him as the mayor of San Francisco as well, and the Speaker of the House of California. I said, Ed, I want you to take a look at this tie. I had a pink and green tie. And I said, Willie, which one do you like? And he said, I like that one. I said, well, if Ed doesn't like it, I'm blaming it on you. And so it ended up, we got to the front, and I said, Mr. Mayor, it would be such an honor for you to wear this pink and green tie. He said, gladly. Well, what he didn't know was that my son was wearing the same pink and green tie, and they look like identical twins. White shirt, dark navy blue suit, and they had this pink and green tie. And so as a result, Ed got there, we had the conference, he got the loudest applause. That you could see that we have the Lunar New Year tying in with Afro-American history right there together on stage, and he's wearing pink and green. So that was a sight to be seen, but it just brought out some great memories with the San Jose chapter of Alpha Kappa Alpha Sorority, that they've always been engaged, and they just had, just a few years ago, the regional right here in the Santa Clara area, but all of us, it was their chapter that led the charge, as well as the other surrounding chapters, to put on the regional conference. So they've been active and have done a lot for our community. And just to share with you that, you know, Alpha Kappa Alpha has had so many well-known figures that have been a part of our sorority, including our very own Vice President of the United States, Kamala Harris. And also, if you're watching basketball, just about 2 weeks ago, we had Ajaya Wilson, who's with the Las Vegas Aces, which is the women's Basketball Association, the WNBA, she's also our member. So we've been watching basketball and going through all of that. We're proud to say we have so many members in so many places. And it gives me great honor because I'm also a member of Alpha Kappa Alpha sorority for over 40 years. And it goes down to my aunt was the international president of Alpha Kappa Alpha, the 19th Supreme Basilisk International President, and it even rolls into my mother. So with this, and I gotta say also one thing, Alpha Kappa Alpha, our theme is always service to mankind. And we serve everyone in our community. And I gotta thank the sorority because when my mother got sick with cancer as a single widowed mother, I had to lean on the sorority back in the day when I was going through college that I did not have to drop out of school, but the sorority stepped in and took care of my mother so I could walk across the stage with my degree. And so I'm indebted with the sorority. This is the greatest love like no other of Alpha Kappa Alpha sorority. And so it gives me great pleasure and honor to welcome all the members of Alpha Kappa Alpha sorority, Eta Rho Omega chapter. Please come up.
As the members come up, I just want to say thank you to Assemblymember Lee. Thank you to the members that were able to come. Our work is, we appreciate the acknowledgement of our work. We'd actually have more members today, but we're actually hosting a voter registration drive, and we're hosting a youth leadership institute today as well. And so our members are split between places. And so taking the time to acknowledge our work in this community, we appreciate it, and I thank you. I forgot to say, I'm Melissa Hawkins. I'm the president of Eta Rho Omega chapter. Thank you. Thank you, Assemblymember Lee. Thank you. Sora, Teresa Cox.
Thank you so much to our co-host, and thank you for Councilmember Cox for subbing in for our co-host who couldn't be here today. I have the distinct honor of recognizing our final, but not least, three honorees. First, I would like to welcome to the stage Jacqueline Van Dyke. Jacqueline was born in Kentucky, raised on a farm, and attended all black schools until her junior year in high school, when the schools were finally integrated. She has been working for the Berryessa Union School District since 1984, proudly serving staff, teachers, and students, and this year she reaches a milestone of 40 years of service. At the beginning of her tenure with the district, Jackie worked various jobs, including noon duty supervisor and school crossing guard, until she was hired as an instructional associate in 1993. Today, Jackie is an instructional associate at Morrill Middle School, where she has been recognized for her leadership and dedication to students and has been honored with the Heart and Soul Award. At Morrill, she is making a big difference by working with students on reflection plans, meeting with parents, psychologists, and social workers to assist with student improvement plans, and acting as a pivotal support system for teachers. She's well respected by students and staff and is considered the school's grandmother who gives love with firmness. Jacqueline and her husband, I don't know if I want to feel that one, but no, Jacqueline and her husband, Alan Van Dyke, have been married for 67 years, and she enjoys being grandmother and great-grandmother.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Fuentes, Assemblyman Lee, Mr. Carroll, my husband, and all the family members who are here. It's been quite an honor for me to work and serve in the Berryessa Union School District. Our children, grew up and went through the schools there, most of our grandchildren, and then some of our great-grandchildren. Every day before I go to school, I've been working, I'm probably the oldest person in the district. And people ask me, when am I going to retire? I make no plans to retire. It's a joy and a privilege every morning when I get up to be able to go to Maria School. Every morning before I go, I ask God to please help me make a difference in at least one child's life. Then it's all worthwhile. Thank you for this honor. It's very humbling, and I thank you.
Next, I would like to bring up Regina Celestin Williams. As a Richmond native, Regina Celestin Williams grew up in an affordable housing project that provides stability for her and other families in the area. She knows firsthand the importance of a safe, stable, and affordable home, and she has dedicated her work to ensure that others experience the same benefit. Regina has over 17 years of experience in affordable housing and community development, including 15 years of structuring financing for affordable housing, working with the National Development Council's East Team at the National Housing Trust. In 2021, she became the Executive Director of Silicon Valley at Home, SV at Home, where she oversees the nonprofit organization, manages its operations, and supports its mission by boosting production of homes at all income levels. Prior to joining SV at Home, Regina was Director of Housing Development for the First Community Housing, a nonprofit affordable housing developer based in the city of San Jose. Regina is a respected community leader and currently serves on the board of directors for Merritt Community Capital and Richmond Land, and as a commissioner on the City of San Jose's Community Stabilization Opportunities Pathways Fund Commission. In 2023, Regina was recognized by the Nonprofit Housing Association of Northern California with the Rising Star Award, and by San Jose Spotlight as one of the 15 most influential Black leaders in Silicon Valley. And in 2019, by the Silicon Valley Business Journal with the 40 Under 40 Award. Regina earned a BA in Urban Studies from Stanford University and a Master's in City Planning from the University of Pennsylvania. She lives in San Jose with her partner and two young daughters. Congratulations, Regina.
Thank you so much, Assemblymember Lee and your team. I feel so humbled to be honored among these honorees today. I'm still trying to figure out what God is trying to do in my life. Everything that I've done to this day is God, and I know that He's trying to do more just by being amongst all of you here today. I did prepare remarks because I'm new to this, so I appreciate your patience. I'm so appreciative for this recognition by Assemblymember Lee and his team and this community. I'm truly grateful to be honored among such great community leaders and to be recognized here in my community. Amongst my family, my mom and my daughters are here today, and amongst my friends, and in my church home. We know that housing policy and practices have been and continue to be primary means for denying equity to Black people in this country. Since the beginning, when enslaved Africans were brought to this country, from living in separate slave quarters to being forced to share crop to live and work on the same property that you may have been enslaved on, to redlining through FHA mortgage lending, to now being displaced and overrepresented in the unhoused population, housing has been used to deeply harm our community. So the work that I do in affordable housing is both deeply personal and so necessarily rooted in the collective. I joined this work because of my personal experience that my family had benefiting from public housing, but I stay in this work because of the more influential rooms that I am in, the higher I rise in leadership, and it may be the older that I get, but the more I understand the concept of Ujima, the collective work and responsibility. Because I cannot thrive until little Black children thrive everywhere, my brothers and sisters returning from incarceration thrive, our Black elders thrive, our Black single parents thrive, young people exiting the foster system thrive, and our Black working families can thrive and be rooted to places that are safe, secure, healthy, and joyful. The more I know about this movement work and how it was started when our ancestors imagined freedom from slavery, I know it will not be done until we realize justice for everyone and restoration for our communities. Thank you. I really appreciate this.
All right, finally, I would like to posthumously extend a recognition to Bishop Oscar E. Dace, Sr. And I will be inviting his family to be accepting an official resolution from the California State Legislature. Many of you know Bishop Oscar D. Dace knew him well, but he was a senior pastor at Bible Way Christian Center, a visionary, community, faith leader, preacher, and teacher whose spiritual message changed the lives of thousands throughout his 35 years of ministry and community service. Under his leadership, Bible Way established numerous ministries to help meet the needs of the underprivileged, to foster healthy family relationships and to address challenging issues facing today's youth and young adults. Some of these initiatives include the Homeless Outreach Program to assist people experiencing homelessness in Silicon Valley, the Destiny Academy Tutoring Program, which supports the congregation and community with tutoring and therapeutic and family support services. As a staunch champion of educational opportunities for young people, Bishop Dace was directly involved with numerous after-school programs, local colleges, and universities. In support of the local community, he hosted many programs and events at the church, from National Night Out and Family Neighborhood Fun Night events to People Acting in Community Together, PACT workshops and functions. He also partnered with the Second Harvest Food Bank's Produce Mobile program to help bring fresh fruits and vegetables to low-income neighborhoods throughout Santa Clara County with the Stanford Alumni Association's Beyond the Farm volunteers help the churches sponsored food bank grocery giveaway. He was dedicated to promoting social justice in San Jose and beyond. Bishop Dace brought a spirit of hope to hurting communities, including to individuals in the criminal justice system. Bishop Dace was known for his integrity and compassion. His passing on January 8th, 2023 was a profound loss to our community. I'd like to express my heartfelt sympathy to his family and friends who, of course, join us today, and he will be surely missed. Now, I'd like to, of course, present the memorial resolution from the California State Legislature to the family.
Thank you all for being here. I did not prepare anything, so I won't be long. I want to thank you. Our pastor, our bishop, was also my father-in-law. And now I serve as pastor with my wife here at Bible Way Christian Center. And we just, man, we stand on the shoulders of a giant. He was truly... He truly was, and in that same spirit, sir, I don't know you, but I know a Titan when I see one. And I would love to get to know you. So I want to thank you all for being here. We promise to continue the work that he was doing. He's being recognized not solely for the spiritual leadership that he provided, but the work that he did in community. And as my sister Regina was up here, we have members that are about that work. And we will continue to make an impact in this community. Look out for us. Collaborate with us. We're not here to do it ourselves, but we are here to get our people free. Amen. All right.
And if we can just have the members of Bible Way stand, you guys have been such a key part of all of the work that we've been doing, Bible Way Christian Center. So we're here too, South Bay and Bible Way. Thank you all so much. Thank you.
So that brings us to the conclusion of today's photo. In a second, I'm going to invite all our awardees and their better two-thirds, if they choose, to come up with their resolutions, and we're going to take a big group photo together. But in the spirit of community, I want to thank so many of you for your outstanding leadership. There's so many of you who are truly outstanding, unsung heroes, and I hope today is one of those few small recognitions to make you feel that the community feels your impact and feels your love. And today, in the spirit of collaboration, as the pastor said, I hope today will foster some new networks, new collaborations, if not renew some old ones too. And of course, I would like to thank the culinary staff of Bible Way today for providing the excellent food and drinks this morning. And also a big thanks to Pastor Sean and Lorianne Gardier and staff for partnering with us today, for allowing us to use this space. I'm very impressed by the setup here with all the TVs and cameras. I feel like I'm about to be on a CNN debate or something. It's very impressive. Like, up here, it's kind of intimidating, actually. And I want to thank my excellent co-hosts, Councilmembers Cox, Campbell, Trustee Norwood, and Tony Alexander. Finally, thanks to my staff, Anurag, Tim, Joe, and Matthew, for organizing and putting this wonderful event together. To everyone, thank you so much for joining us for Black History Month. And I say I'll see you at the next one. Thank you so much. So if I can get the honorees to come up with their certificates, and the co-hosts, we'll do a big group photo together.